Hello there, everyone. My name is Tim J. Kornowski, welcoming you back to a live art demonstration here in my Algoma studio. Hope you all enjoy. Basically, as you can see, there's only a couple lines here and some just sketches. And I wanted to start out really just from the very beginning to show you what I'd like to do today. And we got, hey, Jackie, how you doing? Yeah, I haven't been on Facebook for a while. I've been busy with other things, so have to forgive me for not being here too often. So I've got a painting in the back of Mr. Clay Matthews of the Packers. So he's been hanging up there for a little while now. That's one of my more favorite portraits. So right now I'm sketching out kind of with a Sharpie. This is just a basic Sharpie marker. Nothing real special. Hey, how's it going, Jackie? And what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna work the foreground with, you know, basically I was thinking about using the Precise V5. That's what I use for drawing. I'm actually gonna use the Sharpie in the foreground. And like the caption says, this is a pretty simple, just kind of like a generic fall scene. You know, it is fall up here in the Midwest, and a lot of the leaves are changing colors and people doing a lot of raking around this time, and I haven't started raking myself yet. I just kind of mulch them with my mower. And I'm just going to kind of sketch this out here. Here's an old building with a big old chimney, a lot of character. We're gonna have some fun today. I think art is something we're to have fun with. And if it isn't fun, we have to, you know, there's always work involved, obviously. If it's not work, you're really not doing something right. But I do think there's the element of enjoying what you're doing. And sometimes we get caught up in various other things and we lose our focus. But every now and then it's good to just come back to your roots and try something new. Right now, as you can see, it's just black lines on white paper. But once I draw this entire drawing in, I want to actually color in a lot of the areas that you're going to see here. So there's a lot of this old stonework. You'll see that here in the Kewaunee County, the Door County area. There is a lot of old stone and old buildings, a lot of history. And that's what I like about older homes and older properties, is a lot of character there. And I always like looking back at the past and learning from it, you know, just where did we come from? Helps us understand where we're going. Or how we got to where we are today. So I'm not gonna fill in every spot in shadow with, you know, like with black. I'm gonna leave a lot of that open. And if I want, I can also kind of leave it ambiguous and kind of scribble it in a little bit. And right now I'm really not thinking too much about it. I don't want to let my head get in the way. So there's just this old wood here. And you can kind of fill in the blanks a little bit. You know, you don't have to really put all the details in. I will finish the details. It's kind of like when people are talking, they can imply something and they don't have to finish the sentence. You know where they're going with it, for good or bad. For better or for worse, you kind of pick up on people's mannerisms and you know, there's a lot being said without even speaking. So this is an old chimney on the side of this barn here. And if I want, I can use the freedom to just, you know, color, or go ahead and fill it in with black. Because maybe I want that to be so dark that there's no color that's going to show through. Typically, you'll get that in the foreground of a picture. You'll get a lot of darks. Here's another little barn over here. Again, I'm just using a really basic Sharpie, nothing real special. And maybe I don't want this completely black. Maybe I want to keep it, you know, kind of see-through, because then I can come back later on and add some color to it. Hey, there's my wife. She's watching me draw again. My wife's always been my biggest fan in the arts. Sometimes I'll just run things past her if I'm not sure if something looks right, and I've been looking at it so long that I really can't see it anymore. I'll run it past and sure enough, oh, there's something wrong with this or that. Oh, that's what it is. You know, so I'm not going to be arrogant and think I know it all or I see it all the time. Just because I've been doing art for a number of years. I learned how to paint in oils from the man who designed the Green Bay Packer logo. And, yeah, he taught me a lot. Back when I was about 12, 13 years old, he taught me how to paint in oils. I was born and raised right in the area of the Green Bay Packers Stadium, actually. Got a lot of stories to go along with that. I always like to say that the Packers actually bought out my old house and just tore it down, so I wouldn't be able to visit my old childhood home unless I wanted to go to the sports clinic. One of my favorite parts of this picture here is this really cool old fence. Looks like it's been there for about 50 years. I like old picket fences. You know, everybody since the beginning of time has wanted to roadmap out or you know, make their own section of their own land and kind of say, hey, this is my area. You know, people are territorial for the most part. And, you know, of course, wars have been fought over land. And to this day, if you buy a piece of land, there is a boundary to it. So this is what we have so far, two buildings on a country road. And I'm going to keep working in a little bit more detail here. And then we'll start throwing some color in here if we get the time to do it. But I promise we'll throw some color into it at some point when I feel like it's the right time to do it. There's this big tree towering over here. It's pretty cool. A was listening to an artist who was very handicapped since he was a young child, and he's very small of stature, which means nothing, but I just don't remember his name offhand, so I'm trying to describe him. And so he's got some handicaps, but he's a professional artist doing very well. His art's shown in many places across America. And that was interesting. He had a condition where his bones are like glass, something like that. I'm not sure the name of it. But, yeah, one time his self-esteem was just really low because of that. And so he started using that in his art. He would do self-portraits of himself. Well, of course, a self-portrait, right? And he started to use that in his art. And I think that's when it seemed like things were really taking off, when he became very transparent in his art and, you know, didn't mind showing himself to the world with all of, you know, his perceived flaws or handicaps or whatever. We all have handicaps. Even if it's not physically very obvious, we all have handicaps when it comes to certain areas, and so we need each other's help. So hopefully this little program helps somebody. Even if it's just a simple demonstration for entertainment purposes. But this particular artist was, you know, he's had a lot of unfortunate things in his life where he's had to deal with things that others haven't. But at the same time, he didn't decide to just feel bad about himself. He used it, and he is very, very successful today with his art. There's a lot of successful artists out there that don't have any issues physically. And they quit, they just give up. And I don't think any artist should just give up, even if you never go about it full time. You know, Johannes Vermeer, the guy that painted the girl with the pearl earring, was not a full-time artist. I think we can all agree on that, as art historians would say. He'd had probably a couple dozen to three dozen paintings his entire life. And so he probably just did a lot of art just on the side. And so that's how that worked for him. And he just worked a little bit here and there. And great artist. His art is up there with probably the most expensive art in the world. Yet he was not at all what one might think of as a very successful artist at the time. Rembrandt, he was a very successful artist in his day, and he taught art, of course, too. And so he had a lot of spotlight at that time in his life. He left us many, many thousands, I think, even of drawings, etchings, and paintings. Maybe not thousands, but I would think, well, he's got a very large number of art pieces, and versus Vermeer, who, like we said, has two or three dozen pieces of art that we know of, and we know little to nothing about Vermeer either. Okay, so here's the little road, which kind of reminds me of Door County. There's going to be some leaves that are just kind of strewn about along the road. That's a cool thing about nature, you know. It's like when you go to Texas Roadhouse, you can eat peanuts and throw them on the floor. Well, nature's like that too, you know. You just drops your leaves and just throws them everywhere. You know, it doesn't really matter. They can go anywhere they want, right? Here's some trees in the background. So just kind of a simple sketch today. I can see we're kind of moving right along. We're not going to get, I'll try not to get too detailed anyways. I'd like to do more of like a Bob Ross type of situation where you can see it kind of work itself out very fairly quickly. I really enjoy these country scenes. This is not where I grew up. I grew up in the city, as I said. But I would have really loved to have been born and raised in the country. I think it would have been great. But there was a reason for it. This is kind of an outline, I guess. In a sense, this is like a coloring picture. You know, I kind of work in the colors, or the outlines here and there, and then work in colors after. And I'm going to be using Prismacolor color pencils. If you ever want to give them a shot, they're great. You can get them in any Hobby Lobby. I think I've even seen them at Walmart or Target before, and they're really great to use, so I highly recommend them. I got my sets from my brother. He just gave them to me. Got a little violin music playing here. You can use whatever you want when you're making your art. Maybe you don't want to listen to anything. I tend to enjoy some music when I'm working. So it works for me. So I'm just going to kind of thicken this tree up a little bit. Again, we're just working with a good old Sharpie marker. You can pull off some really nice art with a Sharpie marker, though, I'll tell you. I think we're just going to open the trees up about right here. Put some blue sky in there, something like that. Kind of beef up this background. Prismacolors, I think, are among the best that you can buy, because they're not just like Crayola. They actually have more of an oiliness to them. You can actually use them with oil pastels. That's one of my secrets. If you ever wanted to venture into oil pastels, you can use them together. The colored pencils can pull out details that you wouldn't normally be able to do with oil pastels, because they get so blunt on the ends. So maybe something like that. Let's see what I have in my arsenal of colored pencils. Here we go. So I usually carry a couple of containers of various colors. You can pull off a lot without having to have every color in the spectrum, obviously. And some of them you can just kind of mix and make them yourself. You don't have to have, you know, every single color there possibly is. Let's just say I want to pull out maybe a couple of greens. I like the autumn because you have these bright reds. We'll try to squeeze some of those in there. Sorry, this will just take a moment here. I'm going to grab a few of these colors out. Got a Tuscan red. How about a little neon orange? I don't think we want neon orange, but let's just pull out some of these. There we go. Just a basic orange is good. You also want to have yourself a decent sharpener. And what I mean by decent is you don't want to use the universal side. If you have one of these, I'm gonna use the color. It says backwards on there because you're looking at a mirror image of me right now, so it looks like I'm actually left-handed, but I'm actually right-handed. And let's see if I can find just a decent red. Crimson red sounds good to me. Alright, so I'm gonna use the coloring side. What that does is it makes it not so steep of an angle, as you can see. One of these before that was sharpened without a coloring pencil sharpener makes it very steep in terms of an angle. So I want to get a little red here. If you were putting this color down here and feeling it on the paper, it would feel very waxy or oily. It works pretty good. So where you feel like you need to be generous, then go ahead and do so, because this is your chance. You may not come back around to this spot again. So if you feel like you want to really grind that red in there, I mean, just go for it. I like to actually, you know, when you're drawing on paper, the paper actually has like teeth. And on a microscopic level, it's like, you know, kind of goes like that. And so when you have, you know, paper that's kind of what I'm using, there's a little bump to it. So when you want it really, really thick and you don't want that white showing through, then you have to really kind of grind it in there. You get yourself some Prismacolors and you can find out what I'm talking about. Again, here we go. A nice yellowed orange. They should hire me to make up colored names for them, because they gotta be a little more creative, I think. I could come up with yellowed orange myself. So here in the background, we got a little yellowed orange coming through. The colors of fall kind of blending and mixing together. We've got some greens. This is a really neat green. I'll show you in a moment. It's a apple green, imagine that. You know, it's hard to make an ugly fall painting because there's so much bright colors everywhere. So if you really want to start with a picture, start with a fall picture, because it's, like I said, because it's beautiful colors already, it's hard to mess it up in a way. It's hard to mess it up anyways, I think, if you're just more forgiving when you do your art, instead of beating yourself up over it, and you just kind of learn to have more fun with it. There's a little bit more. There's a little bit of a little yellow that's kicking up in this the bright spot here. Sun's coming through a little bit. And of course, there's yellow sticking out here in the trees. It's really popping out. And again, I'm kind of grinding this right into the paper. Kind of keeping the background loose. The foreground's a little sharper. Obviously, in real life, that's the way it is anyways. But we're gonna go ahead and sharpen this up a little bit. And just kinda be a little random with how you put your colors down. I have a photo reference I'm kinda glancing at here and there because I like the photo so much, it really kinda struck me. But I'm kinda reinventing it. I don't want it to look just like a photograph, and I don't want the same exact scenery. I want to kind of invent off of it. This is what I've done a lot. Artists will do this without even knowing it half the time, even if they don't realize that they could be using something they've heard in the past and not even know it. So it's not plagiarism, it's more so just using something that has inspired me. It's like if you wanted to copy a Rembrandt word for word, so to speak, and not change a thing and then sell it. Well, you can't do that. I do know that there's artists who paint the exact copy of the famous piece of art, so then people can look at that in their house and have the other one tucked away in a bank somewhere or whatever, or a vault. So I know people do that. But for the most part, you know, if you wanted to, like I used to copy the old masters a lot. It's actually, I think it was Pavarotti that found out that was illegal to do. Here's a blue sky. I'm gonna go ahead and put in there real light. Go get crazy with it. Almost look at, make it look like almost like soft pastel. I like the colors of fall. There's a lot of beauty in fall time. I think we can all agree on that. It's fun just to drive down a country lane or a lake shore and and see the colors changing right before your eyes. So I'm going to use a little bit more orange here and kind of work this area in a little bit. And this is where you can kind of blend with your colors. If I don't want that color, I can actually use a green and work into it. So then I have this kind of like orange greenish color. Also, I do not want to neglect using what looks more like a burnt ochre. So many colors I can use. That's what the pencil says anyways, burnt ochre. Maybe you can see it a little bit better. So I'm going to kind of work that into this area here. And actually this burnt ochre is very close to the color I just kind of created without even knowing it. I really enjoy watching the birds migrating, and especially we have a lot of North American geese that come to Algoma and hang out by the lake shore, and you can see them wherever there's open water. Beautiful birds, I never get tired of watching them, and I've spent a lot of time watching their young grow up. They start getting that telltale mark of white on the side of their head that you cannot miss. We're listening to some Bach actually right now. I'll try not to say anything more about it so then Facebook doesn't bar my video. But I do like classical music, not just because usually it's not gonna have royalty issues, but because it creates a nice atmosphere for me when I'm working. So we're just still working in the background a little bit here. You know, if this was on a canvas, you could probably take thinner to Prismacolor. You could probably even paint with it. It's likely anyways. I don't know for sure, but judging by how this stuff feels and how thick it is, it's likely that you could actually pull that off. The foreground is actually like a really kind of a light blue in the shadows. It's kind of interesting. I'm actually using like almost a sky blue to pull that off. The cool thing is these Prismacolors are so strong that you can almost get rid of some of the black that was already drawn in there. It's pretty interesting. Let's see if I can, ooh, this is perfect. It's like a maroon. Let me get this roof drawn in real quick here. Do some really cool stuff with Prismacolor. And not have to even pull out a brush or anything. I specifically like not having to do a lot of cleanup. I like pulling it out, working with it, and then I can kind of, as soon as I'm done, just put it all away real quick. I used to spend hours cleaning up my paints. It seemed just take me half an hour to clean. Then Silicoil came out, and that's a product that's a coil inside of a glass container. So it spreads the brushes out inside the ferrule of the brush really well, and then you can get all the oil paint out of it, because that's the key. You want to get your oil paint or whatever kind of paint out of the brush so you can use the brush again. If you don't clean it out proper, then you'll never be able to use it, or you won't be able to use it for long. I still have brushes I've had for almost 20 years. I just take really good care of them. I used to use brushes that seemed like they had about 5 hairs on it. It was just so small. Thanks a lot, Alan. Appreciate it. Yeah, the next Bob Ross. There can only be one Bob Ross, I do have to say. I do like watching Bob Ross a lot. You know, especially like if you need to take a nap or something. He just had a really soothing voice, and his stories and his pictures were very soothing to look at. So it's not an insult to him. So a lot of times I'll sit and watch the whole program, no problem. But I do notice that if I want to watch something that's relaxing, even the intro song is relaxing. Now he grabbed a big paintbrush and he's painting the picture. Yeah, he was one of a kind, and he really enjoyed nature too. That would be great. Actually, what's really cool about him is that he gave away all those demo paintings. You can't find a Bob Ross original for less than probably 10 to 15,000. A very simple one. Not even the really heavy-duty ones that he made. So those giveaway paintings, that he gave away all of the demos that he did. He would do like 8 shows in a day or something. Yeah, he was a great artist. And there was a time in my life where I didn't think you were a great artist unless you were Rembrandt. So I just wrote off all the abstract artists like they weren't really artists. I just had this horrible, narrow-minded view of art. And if it didn't fit into my little box of Rembrandt and Vermeer and Michelangelo, then, you know, it wasn't art. And so that's pretty rude, of course, too, and arrogant. And later on, as I grew up and I flipped that TV show on Netflix and watched it, I thought, this is really great. Here's the greatness of Bob Ross. When he was working, he actually explained when he'd start working that he'd get ideas. And so, you know, when he was working, he didn't even use a photo reference at all. He's just working from his imagination. And so as he'd work, he'd get ideas. And then his little accidents would turn into these beautiful little mountains. And I thought about it, I go, you know how long it would take for an artist to copy that word for word, so to speak? It would take a long time, and he just did it in a flick of the brush. So that was the greatness of Bob Ross for me. And also the fact that he sat there sharing stories and talking about life while he worked. And that is pretty cool. I think a lot of artists sometimes, anyways, not all of them, but need to step outside the box and learn how to think differently. I think when we do that, we'll be open to new opportunities, and when we're open to new opportunities, then we'll be creating our own opportunities before too long. So, yeah, glad you brought up Bob Ross. He's a great inspiration, I think. And it's sad, because a lot of times I'll talk to some of the people my age or younger, and they've never heard of Bob Ross. And so I like to inform people about, you know, our great teachers that have gone before us. So I'm glad you brought them up. There's a little bit of a green tinge here on this barn. I want to keep this really bold blue here. This is actually an ultramarine. I'm going to see if I can find a dark, probably like a dark, not a violet blue. If I can just find a dark blue. Probably like a navy blue. There's that violet blue again. I got a lot of doubles and triples in here. And we have, maybe that is what I'm looking for, a violet blue. Let's give it a shot. If I don't like it, I can always go over it, right? Or just work with it. No big deal. You know, that's just it, though. It's like Bob Ross said, there's no mistakes, there's only happy accidents. And this is simply a path in the country lane here. Actually have everyone know I was working on that last Facebook Live, and I got to the point where I couldn't fix it anymore. I actually created so many errors in it as I was working on it, I had to actually just put it to the side. I didn't crumble it up and throw it away, even though I felt like it. But there were some things that I could not overcome anymore. And that's the difficulty with drawing at times. There's no way to fix it. Like if you put a bunch of ink, like this ink, in a spot that you just cannot overcome anymore, there are times where it might be time to start over. So don't feel bad if you have to. I had to on that picture. It's a picture of a covered bridge. So I was kind of bummed out about it a little bit, but then a couple pictures later, I had a big success. I did a little portrait of someone, and it came out really well. And I don't mean to brag, I'm just saying it was just hit the spot, you know? And that's just how it is in life, I think, as an artist or anyone. Whether you're, you know, whatever you do, you have your days where you just feel like you're spot on, like you can't miss. Then you have your good days, and then you have certain days that are just kind of rough. And you just never really hit the spot. Sometimes that's just because maybe you didn't sleep very well. All of us, for one reason or another, have gone to bed and slept for a good 8 hours or so, and then woke up the next day and felt like you didn't sleep at all. Why that is, I'm not sure, but, you know, we are humans. We live in these bodies that need a lot of rest and need a lot of care and cleaning and all kinds of stuff. We got to take care of our bodies, and sometimes they just act up a little bit. I'm using a blue to explain what I'm thinking regarding this barn here. Obviously, nobody painted this barn in blue. But the thing is, early in the morning, everything takes on a different color. And so it's kind of interesting how, you know, you think to yourself, what color is it really? I've heard scientists, engineers talk about actual colors and how it could be actually the opposite of the color you're actually looking at. Like this shirt I'm wearing is obviously red, but in the actual color spectrum, it's like it's green or something. It's like the opposite. I don't know. Maybe one of these times I'll have someone explain that, but kind of interesting. All right. Thanks, Alan. You too. Have a blessed time. Enjoy your time at work. I'm going to go ahead and work this color into the roof too. Art's a lot of fun. I know it opens up doors where normally a door might not open. I've often thought that, you know, I could maybe walk into a prison, let's just say, for example. And, you know, I don't look like much of a prison guy, right? So they might call me all kinds of names and this and that. Maybe I don't look like this big tough guy with tattoos everywhere. But there could be respect found where it comes to art. I could say, hey, you want me to draw a portrait of you? And go, oh, sure. You know, and everyone would huddling around going, hey, that's a great drawing. Well, that's how it works with art, you know, and all of a sudden somebody that wants to pick on you or make fun of you for whatever reason, now they think you're pretty cool because you can do a cool drawing. And then what happens is, hey, can you do this? And then, you know, you end up doing a drawing of someone's dog or a picture of their house or whatever, you know. It's just how it works. And I don't think there's very little to nothing that I haven't been able to draw over the years. Maybe things that morally I wouldn't do, but when it comes to ability to do it, I don't know if there's anything I haven't been able to do. Because normally if you can do a portrait, you can usually draw just about anything else. But I can say this, my daughter, Sabella, for example, she'll do a picture and I could say, I don't know where you're getting that. It's like abstract. I don't do abstract. And she's really good at it. And I know that I could try as hard as I want. I just don't have it in me. It would take a miracle to pull that out of me. So there are things that I, come to think of it, am limited in doing when it comes to more imagination. So that's where I'm learning to branch out. And that's a constant work in progress. I think it'd be pretty arrogant of me to say that I can do anything. No. Not true, but I think that humans are capable of learning anything. I think that just about any person on planet Earth can learn how to do this. I don't think we're all a Van Gogh or a Monet or a Michelangelo, because those are special gifts that come around once every, 100 years. But I can say that, if you wanted to learn how to speak French, you can learn how to speak French. You want to learn how to speak, whatever language, or learn how to play piano, you could learn. Maybe you won't be the greatest piano player in the world, but you could learn. So, that was my soapbox for the day. I like to put a little more red in the background, kind of touch up over here. So those are some of my favorite colors in the fall, is the reds. Little explosions in the sky. I had people tell me before, how do you do your drawing and then sit and talk and share stories at the same time? I don't know how you do that. I said, well, I don't totally know either, but I know it helps me make art because it helps me turn my brain off. And that's a good thing. I do think we need our brains, but I think that many times our brains are overworked. And the spiritual aspect of us, the eternal quality of us, just gets completely forgotten. And I don't think it should be that way. I think that that part of us, that people say, oh, Uncle Jerry out there, he's in the cemetery. Uncle Jerry's not in the cemetery. That's just his body. That's just the body he lived in. Like, when there's a funeral, that's not him sitting in the casket. He's gone. He left the moment that he died. And so we just have a shell there to look at and to receive closure or something. So that's the way I've always thought of it as. Just gonna take this and just kind of shoot it down here a little bit. I could be like Bob Ross and just go shoo. And he'd use little sound effects every now and then. That's what helped him make his art. Whatever works for you. But yeah, I think it helps that I get to share with you and share a few stories and talk with people on Facebook here. See if I can turn this a little bit. There you go. Now you can see the whole thing. So, let's see. This is actually not as obvious as I thought it would be. Maybe that's just the what I'm seeing. But this is going to be a blue sky here. I'm going to be darkening it up a little bit. See, the nice thing about Facebook Live, too, is I can actually look in the screen and see what the picture looks like. So, it's pretty cool. I'm going to darken up toward the bottom area where the trees meet the horizon line. I think personally the best art studio is an art studio that's maybe up on a second floor and it has windows that face south, and therefore big windows, the kind of windows that allow a lot of light in all throughout the day, and natural light, not just fluorescent light, which really isn't very good for your eyes in copious amounts. But I would say that's a great view, is to be looking south, because then the sun is actually coming through the trees and you can see them just kind of, they look golden almost. See this, I don't know if you can tell from watching on Facebook Live, but this Prismacolor is so thick. I can lay it on so thick that, it just builds on top of each other. The colors build on top of each other really well. And then you can really kind of grind them into each other and mix them on the paper. Not really mix them like paint, but you'd see when you took two of them and overlapped them, you can mix them together. It's really pretty neat. I want to darken this up here. We have some trees right here. Probably not the only color I'm going to put into these trees. I actually learned this technique without having him demonstrated to me. I think it was taught me by a friend named Larry Huggins, who lives out in California. and he's been talking to me over the years about learning to, you know, let a little paper, a little canvas show through. Just kind of do something loosely, even. Not have to have everything technically accurate and perfect all the time. You know, how else do we learn how to let ourselves go, I guess? And if anyone's familiar with some of the William Harnett paintings, he used to just paint a picture of something that was just a still life just hanging on the wall. And it looked exactly real, like it looked like you could take it right out of the painting. It was tricking of the eye, and that's what I was into. I'm not into that anymore, although I really enjoy the art still. It's not what I... My goal is not for you to say, oh, that looks so real, I want to pull that right out of the paper. My goal is to inspire you, maybe make some art yourself. Maybe you put your art away a long time ago, you need to pick it up again. And go after your personal dreams. There's a lot of greater artists than me out there that just kind of gave up, or maybe they didn't have a mentor, they didn't have a teacher. Well, I can be a teacher for somebody out there, if they let me. And for whatever I know, I'd share it with anyone that want to listen. It's not easy to find a good teacher or a mentor. Sometimes they just not even in your area. So at least we have social media nowadays, which is very important. Allows us to connect with each other across the globe. You can see I'm using the arm motion right now. Then there's the wrist, and then there's the hand motion. I learned that from my art teacher, John Gordon. Now, when we take impressions of things like Claude Monet used to, it's literally just that. What's the first thing you saw? You probably saw the buildings first. Maybe you saw that spot of red first. Whatever it is, I don't want to get every detail. I don't want every brick in there. I'm never going to get it just right anyways. So I'm not going to try. I'm going to take an impression of it. A faithful rendering of it. Not just some scribble, some thing that a little kid looks like they made. Although Picasso said it'd take an artist his whole life to learn how to draw and paint like a child again. So we don't want to downplay that whatsoever. And in fact, if you ever get the compliment as an artist that looks like a child did it, that's a compliment, not an insult. I'm going to kind of choose where I want to put bright notes of yellow here. I'm having so much fun with it, I almost want to pull this into a two-part study. I don't even know how long we've been going. Typically, I go about 60 minutes. You know, I don't have to fit my painting and drawing into 30-minute episodes, although if I did, I suppose I'd find out what I was made of real quick. I have done two-hour paint-outs competitions, and that's where I learned how to paint very quickly. How to be forced into submission when it comes to, hey, paint that scene in about 2 hours, that's all you have. And coming from where I came from, I could spend 300 hours or something on a still life. That's a tall order. Paint that in 2 hours? How am I supposed to do that? So, kind of where I came from. I'm going to put some yellow coming through here. Some little streaks of sunlight. Maybe some yellow on this rock here. Have a little fun with it. You know, you got to use your artistic license, right? Kind of do what you want a little bit. You don't have to be stuck to copying photographs. It's good to admire other artists. And, you know, you can copy them early on when you're learning how to do art, maybe. But if it becomes, like I did, copying that in the sense that you forget who you are as an artist, then you've gone too far. And I think that's what I had done for some years. I lost my creativity. I didn't know who I was, but I did find out who I was as an artist, not through oil paints, but through colored pencils and oil pastels, which is interestingly enough. I want to pull out a violet, do something a little different here. I did have someone watching me paint once, and this bystander had said, you know, there's one color in there I'm just not seeing. I thought it was interesting that somebody picked up on this. They didn't see much violet. I thought, huh, I don't know why. I wasn't trying to not use violet at all. I just hadn't thought of using it. So here we are, whoever that was out there that told me that. As I was painting on my easel that day. Here is some bright violet we're using in the foreground. Felt like we needed something dark and something that would contrast all these brighter, lighter colors behind it. So that helps it pop out. Of course, purple is really strong against yellow because they're total opposites. It's like a marriage. I think the best marriages are people who marry, that their personalities are total opposite. Like one sees black and white, and one is, you know, sees it from maybe all sides or whatever. And it just kind of like, there's more than one way to look at a situation or a problem or, you know, a person or whatever without judging them. It's not just my viewpoint. It's what does someone else see? They could see it as a blessing, I could see it as a curse, and then say, oh yeah, okay. It's interesting, maybe I'll change my viewpoint on that. Maybe I'll act for a moment like I don't know everything, right? It's very true. I'm gonna use a little bit of violet over here too. Build up the... shadows, let them come on out. I like the idea of having some violet down here too. Of course, I used an ultramarine, which is very close to violet. Maybe because the sunlight is so bright, I'm just going to outline a little bit of it on here, on this building. I like this little old chimney sticking up. You know, maybe nobody's using it anymore, but it's really cool. I like old things, they have a lot of character. Especially when they still work, then they're even nicer when you can still use it like an old truck. A lot of guys they'll pay top dollar for an old truck that still works. An old friend lives in the Green Bay area. His dad had passed away, and we talked about how, you know, I remember him because he always listened to Alabama's song, One More Shot. Give me one more shot, you know. And he said, interesting you mentioned that, you know, he listened to that song all the time. It's still sitting in that old truck. That tape cassette's still in there. Also going to use probably some violet here on this tree, and I'm also going to blend, of course, some dark brown in there, but the shadow color is very cool. See, some people, if they saw me doing that, they think, what are you doing? That makes no sense. Trees aren't purple. How could you use that color? So I'm just looking for brown right now. I think I have a brown here somewhere. I think I would. Sepia. Sometimes I don't know what colors I'm gonna use until I start into it. Other thing is, you don't want to bang these colored pencils around too much because you can actually break the colored lead inside. And then when you go to sharpening it, you can actually ruin your colored pencil because as you sharpen it, pieces are just falling apart inside. That's how it works. Trust me, I know, because I dropped a couple on the ground. And then all I do when I try to sharpen it is have little pieces coming out of the stick. Doesn't happen too often, but if I'm not being watchful enough, it can. I'm gonna take a quick look back here. Excuse me for a moment. Sometimes it's good as an artist to be able to kind of look back and study what you're doing. Then you don't see it so close up, you actually see it further away. So that helps a lot. I'm just going to look for one more here, and we'll kind of button it up for the night. Sometimes it's just the art of finding a good spot to stop. Oh, just one more thing, and then, you know, it's 20 more minutes. So you kind of have to watch yourself. Look for a good place to stop, just like when you're reading a book, you know. Maybe you want to go to the next chapter, whatever works for you. Nice thing is I could, as you could see, I could still work in a little bit of this permanent marker right over the top of some of it. You know, if you did this with oil pastel, it wouldn't work at all. It would just gum up and, you know. But you always want to leave the door open where you could come in and work things out a little bit more. Like, this is a lot of long grass that nobody mows. You know, it just kind of hangs out. Does its own thing, you know, it doesn't have to, you know, be cut down ever. That's what I like about the country, you know, there's stretches of woods that, you know, nobody cares. Nobody's landscaping any of it, they just let it grow any old way it grows. And this is where you wonder, like, what's at the end of this road here? You know, and that's the whole point. That's the journey of life. It's not about constant destinations and, oh, I'll be happy when I get here. No, it's the journey that you really have to enjoy. And if you can't enjoy the journey, you'll never be happy at the destination anyways. So you might as well just enjoy your life each and every day. So thank you everyone for watching. Feel free to share this with anyone else you please. We'll go ahead and probably finish this up probably this week. I'll try to alert everyone ahead of time, or else you'll get an alert with our name on it, Kornowski Originals. And we'll look forward to finishing this picture up this week. And thank you everyone for watching and your comments. I really appreciate it. Again, if you want to share this with anyone, or if you want to know, you know, how much would it cost for a piece of art like this, or could you do something else that you've always wanted to hang on your wall, let me know. I'll give you a free quote. I'll make something work for you. And I appreciate everyone's time, and your time is valuable to me, and I appreciate everyone watching, even if you just stop in for 5 minutes and check it out. Be sure to see the finish of this most likely this week, and thank you everyone for tuning in. And I look forward to seeing you all very soon. Thank you very much. Have a good night, and God bless.